Good morning. Good morning. Thank you, Rod, for the introduction. And it's my pleasure to welcome you all, both here in the room and on the radio audience, to today's meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you are in the know. I'm Mort Downey, former Deputy Secretary of U.S. Department of Transportation and a senior advisor to Parsons Brinckerhoff, as well as other things I do, and I'll be your moderator for today's program. You can find the Commonwealth Club on the internet at commonwealthclub.org. And today's program is being co-sponsored by the Mineta Transportation Institute. It's also being held in association with the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, the American Public Transportation Association, and the Bay Area Metropolitan Transportation Commission. What we're going to talk about this morning is something that, in fact, affects every American, and that's the funding of America's infrastructure. A lot of people, I think rightfully, are concerned about the lack of investment in our national highways and bridges, transits, and airport systems. One wonders, are we in fact becoming a second-class country when it comes to our investment? Well, our panel of transportation experts bring us viewpoints from the national, state, regional levels. Hopefully, we'll be talking about possible solutions, some of the revenue options, what will the public think about those policies, and we'll be very anxious to hear the results of a newly completed survey on these topics. But I think this should be really a conversation about where are we going? What's the state of our transportation system? There's a little bit of good news from Washington, hard to believe, but there's talk of actually completing a transportation reauthorization bill in the next few days. The leaders, Senator Boxer, Chairman Mica of the House Transportation Committee, have been closeted for 2.5 days now, trying to work out those details. No assurance they actually will get there. And on the other hand, if they do, this is only going to be a bill that runs for the next 15 months. It's a 2-year bill, but the first year is almost over. So we're going to be back next year again looking at these issues and looking at the future. There are some bright spots out there. Safety in particular, I'm just really struck each year when I look at the numbers on automobile deaths in this country. They're down to they're down from an unacceptable level of 50,000 a year to an unacceptable level of 30,000 a year, but that represents enormous progress. I mean, I'll be happy when the day comes we can say we've eradicated traffic deaths like we've eradicated polio, but we have a lot of work to do that. But that's a bright spot. Technology is another bright spot, what the transportation system has been able to do in picking up the available technology that comes out of Silicon Valley and use it to provide better service for our customers. We also see a few really good projects around the country. Steve Heminger's bridge here, the Bay Bridge, is certainly one. Light rail systems, ports that are rebuilding themselves to adapt to the opening of the Panama Canal expansion. So those are some positives. There's an awful lot of worries that are there. Are we doing enough to invest in the system to serve the future? We're going to have 100 million new Americans by mid-century. We're not going to have transportation infrastructure unless we start building it now. And what does that bode for the future? We also have all of our investment over the last decades is still out there. We're not reinvesting fast enough to keep it in good shape, to keep it working for the people. We still have energy issues that we've got to address, and we've got financial issues. I'm sure we'll talk about how transportation gets paid for and the fact that at least at the moment we're locked into a tax on gasoline at the same time that we want to consume less gasoline. We want to use this fixed amount per gallon to deal with our investment. We've got to think our way through that. Fundamental question is what's the problem? Are we not communicating well? We're not making the sale in terms of what we need to do. We're making it well at the local level, and we'll hear from Will and Steve about how that is working, how people are both willing to pay for new investment and willing to use the new investment. But at the national level, it's just not percolating up. So we really have to think about our future. is the future at the national level? Is it at the local level? What's the role of the public sector? What's the role of the private sector? Again, next year, when this current legislation, if we get it, is complete, we're going to begin this conversation again. And I hope the people who are up at the table with me will continue to be part of that conversation. We should not be part of the problem. We should be part of the solution. Let me introduce our panelists. To my left, Dr. Asha Agrawal, Director of the Mineta Transportation Institute's National Transportation Finance Center, as well as Associate Professor in the Urban and Regional Planning Department at San Jose State University. Dr. Agrawal has worked in transportation finance for more than 10 years and has additional research interests, transportation planning and policy, planning for pedestrians and cyclists, and transportation history. We'll learn something from transportation history. She holds a BA from Harvard, a master's degree from the London School of Economics, and a PhD from University of California, Berkeley. Will Kempton has spent, it says here, nearly 40 years in transportation. I've spent more than 50, so Will is catching up with me. But in transportation, public service, and government affairs. Since 2009, he has been the CEO of the Orange County Transportation Authority. Responsible for planning, financing, and coordinating the county's freeway, street, and rail development, as well as managing bus, commuter rail, and paratransit services, the kind of multimodal arrangements that we need. Will previously spent 5 years as director of California Department of Transportation, having been appointed by Governor Schwarzenegger. In that position, he oversaw 22,000 employees and was responsible for managing the daily operations of this state's transportation system, including its 50,000 miles of highways. Mr. Kempton is recognized as an authority on public infrastructure financing, sales tax-funded programs, and, very importantly, project delivery. To Will's left is John Horsley. John has spent similar number of decades in the transportation world, both at the federal and the local level. He is currently, but not for long, Executive Director of the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, a post that he's held since 1999, but is relinquishing next year to move on to other interesting things. The association advocates policies and provides technology leadership on behalf of the states to improve our nation's transportation system, and is also a multimodal interest. Previously, Mr. Horsley served as Associate Deputy U.S. Secretary of Transportation during the Clinton administration, and one of my colleagues in the department doing very interesting and exciting things. In that role, he was the department's advocate for intermodal policies, for quality of life initiatives, and he served as liaison to government, state, local, the Congress, and the transportation constituencies. Prior to coming to Washington, John was elected to 5 terms. As county commissioner in Kitsap County, west of Seattle. He is also a graduate of Harvard University. I feel outnumbered here as an Eli. Michael Melaniphy is the president of the American Public Transportation Association, APTA, which advocates in Washington, D.C. in support of their over 1,500 public and private member organizations. He comes out of the business side of transit, representing motor coach industries for 10 years, and also on the public side, having led Charlotte, Wichita, Hamilton, Ohio, and Laredo, Texas transit agencies for 11 years. He has a BA in business from Indiana University and an MBA and postgraduate work from Wichita State. Michael also serves on several higher education and nonprofit boards. And down at the end of the table, one of your locals, Steve Heminger. Steve is executive director of the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, the regional transportation planning and finance agency for this 9-county Bay Area. The MTC allocates more than $1 billion a year in funding. That's why everybody likes Steve. He's got money to hand out. Funding for the operation, maintenance, and expansion in a planned way of the Bay Area's surface transportation network. This also includes the administration of all the toll revenues from the 7 state-owned bridges, as well as issuing revenue bonds to finance bridge, highway, and transit construction. Steve was appointed by House Democratic Leader Nancy Pelosi to serve on a body known as the National Surface Transportation Policy and Revenue Study Commission, which did a lot of work in the lead up to what has been a long process of a reauthorization bill, and all the things that they had done are still there to be looked at when we really get to looking at serious long-term funding and policy. In addition, Steve is the chair-elect, will take over from me as chair of the Board of Trustees for the Mineta Transportation Institute, and is president of the Board of Directors for the Association of Metropolitan Planning Organizations. He holds a master's degree from University of Chicago and a bachelor's degree from Georgetown. Please welcome all of our panelists. Well, with that introduction and with the largely gloomy, but maybe with a few rays of sunshine news about legislation, let me start asking each of you to provide your perspective on the issue of America's infrastructure, and particularly, where will we find the money needed to both sustain it and to improve it? I'm going to give each panelist about 8 minutes. I will enforce that time with this gavel. I will gavel or hit you, whichever I can reach, to keep to that, because we do want to have good time for discussion, good time for questions and answers. Dr. Agrawal from the Mineta Institute will begin by presenting, hot off the press, the latest MTI National Transportation Finance survey data and trends from prior years as background information, showing that there are some funding increases that are supported by the voters, and if you can tell us what it is that persuades them to do that, we will all be in your debt. Asha?
Thank you, Mort, for that introduction, and thank you also to the organizers of today's event for inviting me to share the results of this new public opinion poll funded by the Mineta Transportation Institute that was released today. So you're getting breaking news here. We looked at support for federal-level taxes for transportation, with a particular focus on gas taxes and the idea of a mileage tax. And just to give a little context, I mean, why are we interested in public opinion about taxes? Obviously, there's concern that we need more funding, and it seems to be conventional wisdom that you read in the newspapers or might hear at an event like this, that Americans hate, well, taxes in general, but that they just hate the gas tax, and there's really no way we could possibly raise it. But is this true? Now, the truth on any matter of public opinion is always tricky to pin down. But I would suggest that the data I would present today is perhaps not quite as bleak as we might think, as conventional wisdom might hold. I would argue that politicians may hate gas taxes, but that the public, while they may not like them, is perhaps not quite as opposed as we're often told is the case. So the survey in question that we just completed was a random digit dial phone survey where we very carefully interrupted people either at dinner or some other equally inconvenient time for them. And there were a very nice 1,519 people who did agree to complete our survey. It was in English and Spanish, and we did talk to people on both landline and cell phones. Now, before leaping in and giving you some of the numbers, what did we learn? I want to stress that I don't think our results should be interpreted as a good predictor of how people would respond to or vote on any specific tax increase proposal, because opinions vary enormously on the context in which such an initiative might be put forward, and also very much on how the tax is framed, discussed, described. But what I think our survey results can do really well, and this is where I think their value is that they can show us the relative support for different kinds of taxes, say a mileage tax versus a gas tax, and also the different levels of support depending on how we frame and describe the taxes. So that's where I would encourage you to really pay attention to the results of our project. So we asked about different versions, two versions of a mileage tax and eight different versions of a gas tax. So let me start off with just the plain Jane versions, the very simple, no frills, where we were told first that people, would they support a 10-cent increase in the federal gas tax to support transportation, so very general here. And then the equivalent of that was we asked people about would they support a new mileage tax that would be a penny per mile, again, just for transportation. Well, we got pretty clear results here. These were not popular taxes, unfortunately. Maybe not too surprising, but for the 10-cent gas tax increase, we only got 20% of people saying they would support it. Interestingly, the mileage tax was actually slightly more popular with 21%. Neither one is too popular. But that is just the starting point. What I really want to stress is what happens when we compare the results people's opinions on those taxes with other versions of the mileage and the gas tax. We found that every variation on those base cases, as I'll call them, got substantially higher support levels. So just to give you a few examples, the mileage tax. So the base case was just this penny per mile for everyone. We also asked about a version, which as shorthand to you all, I'll call the green version, where we told people that it would be an average rate of a penny per mile, but that your actual rate would vary depending on the pollution level of the vehicle that you drive. Well, support for that tax was 41%. This was almost a 20 percentage point increase in support just by shifting how the rate was structured to give it this green slant. And similar pattern holds when we look at the variations on the gas tax options. So, for example, we also asked, well, what if instead of charging you just 10 cent increase at one time, we split that over 5 years, so 2 cents a year for 5 years? Well, we got an increase in 19 percentage points of support, up to 39%. And similarly, when we asked, well, what if this, we did a 10 cent all at one time increase in the gas tax, but we dedicated the revenues to projects that would reduce the transportation system's impact on global warming. And we saw a 21 percentage point increase in support, up to 41%. And then finally, actually the most popular version we asked about among the different gas tax variants was a tax where the 10 cent increase in the gas tax with the revenues dedicated to maintaining streets, roads, and highways. And here we saw a 38 percentage point increase in support, up to 58%, which is a pretty comfortable majority. I think a lot of people running for office would be happy if the polling told them they had 58%. Now, let me turn to the fact that this is actually the third in a series of polls. We've been asking the same set of questions several years now to try and see, well, what's changing, or is nothing changing? And actually, when we compare this year's survey results to the previous 2 years, there's a very simple message. Virtually nothing has changed. Support levels are almost identical. And I think that's a very important finding because it shows that the survey is reflecting real and deep opinions within the American public. We clearly, our survey didn't just get a strange group of people 1 year who don't represent the full population well. And also, people's opinions seem to be fairly stable. It's not like, you know, 1 month they seem to be thinking one way and the next month radically different. So let me now turn to a new element of this year's survey, which is we wanted to delve a bit more closely into people's opinions about public transit, their understanding and support for revenue for transit, and again, different ways they might support funding it. One of the heartening findings, for those of us who believe that there's great value to public transit, is that 83% of respondents said that expanding and improving transit is an important priority for their state. So clearly, broad support for transit, improving it. We also checked to see if people knew which levels of government support transit, and we found that the federal government's role is not well appreciated. Only 42% of people said that they knew that the federal government contributed money to funding transit. And then lastly, I'll just share one other highlight. We did ask if people would support raising either gas taxes or transit fares to expand and improve transit. And actually, neither of these options got particularly strong support, and neither certainly got majority support. So let me wrap up. One can take these surveys with the sort of glass half full or the glass half empty perspective. You can say, well, gosh, some of those numbers are pretty low. Does that mean public's really not so supportive? I would say that there are actually very encouraging lessons that come out of these survey findings. First, that support for gas or mileage taxes can be significantly increased, significantly, if we carefully design those taxes, both how we structure the tax, what we use the revenues for, and how we explain it to the public. And I don't think that's a cynical message that, oh, it's just marketing and spin. I think that that just means, okay, as transportation professionals, we need to figure out what a revenue program that will meaningfully help us is, and look at what the public supports, and then find where those two mesh well, and that's where we have to put our energies. Secondly, one of the things that we can do, among others, that I think will significantly improve support for transportation taxes and have other really important public policy benefits, is to start linking transportation taxes to environmental benefits. That's clearly one message that resonates with the public and would allow us to use our transportation system to also achieve the incredibly important goal of improving our natural environment. So with that, I thank you for your attention and look forward to questions and to hearing what my fellow panelists have to say.
Thank you, Asha. Now I'll turn to Will Kempton from Orange County Transportation Authority. From that local perspective, what do you see in terms of challenges and options for getting transportation funded?
Well, thank you, Mort, and again, thanks to the Mineta Institute for sponsoring the forum and to the Commonwealth Club for hosting us. I was going to say, Asha, if you got any favorable response on the question of taxes, you certainly didn't do any polling in Orange County. Very, very conservative area. For those of you who are not familiar with Orange County, California, it is amazing to me, being a transplanted Northern California, to see the depth of the conservative viewpoint in that county. I think it's important, however, in saying that if you look at our organization, the Orange County Transportation Authority, we are all things surface transportation in the county. And while you might think when you have thoughts of Southern California that the car is king, and it certainly, I think, is, but in Orange County, we do have a very large transit-dependent population. We have a very robust bus system, less robust since the last couple of years, but we have about 550 vehicles in our fleet. We have 77 routes. Last year we had 51 million boardings, and our ridership is up this year. So while more people use the automobile, by far, there is a very significant transit operation in Orange County. I would say that with respect to where we go, I will just deliver the message, and you'll hear more about this from John and Mike and probably Steve as well. We need reauthorization now. If you don't know, a major issue before the Congress at this point is the authorizing legislation to govern the program makeup and the expenditure limits for transportation going forward for the next several years. The only problem is, by virtue of the number of extensions that have occurred over the past several years, and I was surprised in talking to Mike today, it's been 3 years since the previous authorizing legislation expired. We've gone through 9 extensions. Mike will talk a little bit more about the history of that, I'm sure. But the fact of the matter is, we need reauthorization now. So what are the impacts of not having a federal transportation authorizing bill? Well, I can say them in just two very simple terms. First of all, you have the service implications. You're not able to plan for transportation facilities because transportation is a long lead time program. Anytime you're building major infrastructure or even maintaining basic infrastructure in terms of vehicles, in terms of rolling stock, in terms of the rail facilities, in terms of freeways and highways, it takes a long time to plan for those investments. And so there is a service implication by not having a longer term vision for transportation. So it impacts the infrastructure and service operations. But there's also a very significant economic benefit to having a transportation authorizing bill in place, and that impacts all of us. Just in our county alone, the transportation program that we've been able to cobble together without knowing what we're going to be able to do in the future has been able to create or sustain 12,000 jobs in our little transportation sector. So that's a pretty startling impact when you look at this, you know, more globally, as far as the jobs that are created and maintained by virtue of the transportation program and the transportation industry. So how do we get people to support transportation? I like to break down things simply. I am a newly appointed professor at the Mineta Transportation Institute, teaching transportation finance, and I try to break all that complexity down into simple terms for my students. So that's what I'm going to try to do for you today. I think there are three things that we need to do to get people to support transportation. The first is reform. I'll go into that in more detail. The second is efficiency, and the third is performance-based programs. So let's start with the first one, reform. I think the public does not have a very positive view of how we do business in the transportation community, or transportation program rather, or for that matter, how we operate government in total. So reform is a very critical element. When you tell people at public hearings on transportation projects that it takes 10 years to develop a major transportation project from the twinkle in the planner's eye to the point that you're getting construction underway, they just roll their eyes. They can't believe that. Their expectation is that you decide to do a project and you should be out there in maybe 6 months, and you should be doing that work and getting it done so that the public can benefit from it. We need to streamline the process. How often have you heard that term? We need to make the process more efficient. And I'm not talking about, in making that process more efficient, doing away with environmental protections or even reducing environmental protections. I'm talking about just figuring out ways to take less time to do business. We offered up, as part of an effort on the reauthorizing legislation, something called breaking down barriers. I'm happy to say that those reform measures, or at least some of them, are included in both versions of the reauthorizing legislation that now sits before Congress. And with the passage of those reforms, there will be some improvements in the time and reductions in the time it takes to process transportation projects. Procurement. We need to look at better ways to procure our work. The limitations on design build, the limitations on the ability to bring in the private sector to do risk transfer, to do all of those things. It's particularly severe in California because of the power of the employee unions. We need to be able to be more efficient, make those reforms in procurement as well. And we need to encourage private investment. That's not the panacea by any stretch of the imagination, but it is a tool in the toolbox that needs to be looked at. Efficiency, on the transit side, we're like every other transit operation, I think, in the state of California. We drive 40-foot buses all over the county, except, guess what? In the central part of the county, those buses are full. Where there's a demand, we can load the buses up. We have people waiting. We have buses actually having to drive by because there's so much demand in the central or core area of Orange County. Yet we run those same 40-foot buses in the south part of the county where I live, and there's maybe two or three riders on them. So not to say that we shouldn't be providing transit options in those areas where there isn't as much demand, but let's do it differently. So we did a transit system study, and we're looking at van pools, we're looking at smaller vehicles, we're even looking at, for our access service, instead of sending a van out for the people that are disabled to provide transportation services for them, why not send a taxi? It's cheaper. And we saved $700,000 last year by implementing taxis in the non-peak hour service for our access operations. We need to focus on throughput. Can't just go out and widen roadways. We're looking at the I-405 project in Orange County right now. There's five lanes of latent demand out there. We want to add an express lane coupled with an HOV lane for an express facility in the median so that we can move more people through that corridor and get a longer-term return on investment. Mort already mentioned technology. We really do need to implement technology in terms of intelligent transportation systems, fare integration for our transit and rail operations. When I was the director of Caltrans, I suggested that a portion of the bonds, Prop 1B bonds that Governor Schwarzenegger introduced to the voters in the 2005 year, calendar year, and I said we need to set a good chunk of those dollars aside for technology development, for intelligent transportation systems. The pressure for freeway and highway projects overcame that, and there was very little money set aside for that purpose. And then finally, the performance-based part of the program, people need to know what they're getting. This business about talking about $500 billion worth of needs in California goes right over everybody's head. We need to be specific. That's why our self-help counties, county programs in California, where counties tax themselves locally to provide for transportation improvements, are so successful, because we tell the voters precisely what they're going to get, and we deliver on those promises. So performance-based programs are absolutely important in the way we do business. Transparency and accountability is also an important element of the program. I think we talked about the distrust or mistrust in government, and we need to make these programs transparent and accountable. I will close on one final issue, and that's the messaging, because I don't think we are doing what we need to do to get the message out. We tend to preach to the choir. Go to a transportation summit, even in this room. I would wager that just about everybody in this room has some interest in transportation. We need to be involving people from business, people from education, people from public safety. Get the word out to them. Get them talking to our elected officials about the need for transportation and the benefits it provides for those sectors. That's absolutely critical. So you can't just talk in terms of needs. And you got to make the message a little more simple. And I want to give you just one example of this. We did a study at the request of Commissioner Lucy Dunn. She wanted to know what it costs to operate the roadways in simple terms that people could understand. So we looked at the average mileage of a vehicle, 25 miles per gallon, and we took a 25-mile stretch of roadway, and we calculated the cost of what the expense for that vehicle driving on the roadway was in terms of long-term maintenance, life cycle costs, the construction costs, and everything else, came to $1.19 for that vehicle to travel over that 25-mile stretch. What was the customer paying? 53 cents. So we're underpaying, we're underinvesting, and if we don't take care of this problem, folks, this country is going to become the next United Kingdom of the 21st century.
Thank you, Will. Now, John Horsley, can you talk about the national significance of our infrastructure maintenance, and particularly what all of these delays in getting reauthorized have meant to our goals that we're trying to achieve with the program?
Sure, Mort. And first of all, I want to say it's great to be here in San Francisco with the Commonwealth Club again, and thank the Mineta Institute for sponsoring this event. I look forward to this each year. I'm honored to represent all 50 state departments of transportation around the country, and there's none finer and more effectively managed than Caltrans. Will was the leader there with great effectiveness, and now Malcolm Dougherty, and I'm very honored to represent Caltrans. But I'm also pleased to be here with Steve Heminger, who manages and leads one of the finest metropolitan transportation organizations, planning organizations in the country. So right here in your own backyard of the Bay Area, you have one of the national leaders in the MTC, so it's great to be here. And also pleased to be sitting next to Mike Melaniphy. I'm a highway guy. I represent the state agencies. Mike represents all the transit agencies. We're in it together in the need for this bill. And Mort, you bring up the one of the key issues. What are the consequences of delay in enacting a long-term bill? We're 3 years late. 3 years late. And if you're a state DOT like Will was managing Caltrans, you have to have certainty to plan the projects, let the bids, and execute long-term improvements in the transportation system. If you have uncertainty, and we're in the ninth extension and perhaps going to a tenth, it almost makes it impossible to spend your dollars as effectively as you need to. So we did a survey of our members in North Carolina, for example, said they had to delay $1.2 billion in key projects because of the uncertainty of the bill. Nevada DOT said, we're ceasing doing design work. We're shutting down all design work because how can we justify doing design work if we don't know if we're going to have any money over the next couple months? And folks, 40 to 45% of what we invest in highways in this country, and the same for transit, comes from federal spending. In education, it's 6 to 7% comes from the national level. So it's absolutely crucial if we're to have a competitive, viable national transportation system, the federal government's got to do its part. Congress has got to do its part. Well, Mort, let me tell you, I am optimistic for the first time in 3 weeks. 5 weeks ago, when the House finally found a way to go to conference with the Senate, and that's where you get the two parties at the table negotiating a final bill for the president to sign, 5 weeks ago, I was optimistic. Then 3 weeks ago, it looked like negotiations had fallen apart. But let me tell you, folks, you are represented by one of the finest senators in the entire country, Barbara Boxer, and she's, and let's hear it for Barbara Boxer. She is determined to pass a bill, and she has pounded away relentlessly on her colleagues in the Senate and the House, and miraculously, over the last 2 days, what we've finally seen is the House come around and talking seriously with Senator Boxer, and it's my bet right now, I'm going to put it on the table, by Labor Day we're going to pass a bill. Now, let's see if the Congress makes a fool out of me. But I think they're going to pass a bill. And Will, you're touching on one of the things that is the driver in the enthusiasm, even amongst some of the most conservative members of the House, and that is this bill will contain significant reforms. Steve was on a national commission that outlined the reforms that were needed, and the bill in both the House and the Senate are crafting reforms that will make a difference. They're going to consolidate the program. They're going to accelerate project delivery. They're going to find ways to stretch the dollars through innovative financing measures. Mayor Villaraigosa of LA has been behind that measure. And they're going to require performance measurement and reporting on results. So this will be a reform bill. They're going to sustain current levels of investment if they can ever stop the bickering and reach an accommodation, the House with the Senate with the House, and present a bill for the, to the President to sign. Well, let me wrap up by one final observation. The challenge, and the reason we haven't had a bill for 3 years, is no one can figure out how to pay for it. We're spending in the out of the Highway Trust Fund about $52 billion each year, but revenue flowing into the trust funds only coming in at $36. Now, even at the federal level, if you spend at 52 and revenue comes at 36, you realize you got a problem. It's been sustained by reserves and transfers. Well, that can't continue. So we've got to find an ongoing way to sustain investment, and probably without raising taxes. Now, Heminger is one of the smartest guys in the country. He and I agree that we probably aren't going to succeed the next couple of years by a fuel tax increase. But if we shift to a sales tax as the basis for funding the national system, a sales tax on fuel, and the price of oil goes down over the next couple of months and we have a new baseline, that might be an opening. If it appears to be a revenue-neutral change, but over time, as prices inevitably will go up over the next 10 years, that might be a way to sustain the program. So that's an idea.
Thank you, John. Now we'll hear from Mike Melaniphy from American Public Transportation Association about what the needs are of our nation's transit systems and, again, what congressional delays have meant to that transit industry.
Thank you, Mr. Downey. I appreciate that. Good morning, everyone. It's wonderful to be here at the Commonwealth Club. I thank you for the opportunity and thank the Mineta Institute as well. Public transportation is on a tremendous roll right now. We are seeing ridership increases across this country like we haven't seen in decades. Last year, we saw the second highest ridership increase since 1957. Total ridership numbers. We had 10.4 billion trips on transit last year, a 2.3% increase over the previous year. And in the first quarter of this year, we saw a 5% increase in ridership over last year, 5% increase in the first quarter. Transit is on a tremendous roll right now. And we're not just seeing it in pockets across the country. We're not just seeing it on specific modes. We're seeing it in the north, the south, the east, the west, rural communities, heavy rail, commuter rail, bus. People are flocking to public transportation, not just in big numbers, in record numbers. As we look even in the state, Oakland and San Diego set record ridership numbers. We're seeing it across the country. People get it. They are using public transportation. What's driving them to ride public transportation? Certainly a big part of that has been volatile and high gas prices. And it's not just the highness of the gas prices, but the volatility. But one of the great things that's happened, and we've been able to statistically prove this, is that while people come to transit because of fuel prices, they stay because of the quality of the service. We've got vehicles that are very new, they're good looking, we've got sexy looking trains and buses, they've got Wi-Fi on them, they've got real-time application information, we can see on signage when the next bus or the train is coming, And now the newest, really exciting wave is we've got apps across the country that systems are putting out that you can see when the train is coming, when the bus is coming. You know what the fare is. I call that the demystifying process of transit. All of us get nervous about trying something new if we don't know when the train's coming, how long it's going to be till the next bus, or what is the fare going to cost. We're apprehensive about riding. But now that we've got these new technologies that allow us to see all that right on our phones, and pretty soon we're going to be able to pay for those trips with our mobile devices, it's really exciting. And it's made the ridership experience so much more inviting and welcoming. And people have come to transit. And as fuel prices have come down, people have stayed on transit. It's not a linear drop. People have stayed time and again on transit, and it's a great story. As my good friend Will talked about, one of the big things on when you talk about local ballot initiatives is to tell the story exactly what it is you're going to do. As the study that was done by the Mineta Institute and just released yesterday talks about, if you just say we're going to raise taxes for better transportation, you get one level of response. As you talk about specific projects like Will's done in Orange County, the response rate goes much higher. Now let's look at that at a national level. There were 28 local ballot initiatives for transit across the country last year. 22 of them passed. In some of the worst economic times in our lifetime, we had a 78% passage rate for local transit initiatives in this country. Big cities, small cities across the country. Why? Because people said, I am willing to pay for a better option, for a better choice. They're doing that with their local dollars. They're speaking out. And it wasn't just last year. We had a 77% passage rate in 2010. We've been tracking this data since 2000. Over the last 12 years, we've had a better than 70% passage rate on local transit initiatives across this country. So if you tell people what you're going to do, you deliver on specific projects, they will absolutely support that. And we're seeing that over and over again. And some statistics on that. In the 1980s, there were 7 light rail systems. There are 36 light rail systems across the country now. In 1989, there were 9 commuter rail systems. Now there are 28. People are looking for options. They don't want to be stuck in traffic all day. They want to have a better quality of life. They want to be able to read, rest, do better quality of life things on public transportation. And they're proving that time and again. Ashto and APTA worked together on a study called the Bottom Line Report. We looked at what are the capital needs in public transportation and transportation infrastructure as a whole. They found that there was a $59 billion annual requirement for state of good repair in the public transportation sector. Just investment to keep our systems running strong, safe, efficient, dependable on time. That's going to be a continuing need over and over again. And currently, our systems fund at about a $15 billion level versus a $59 billion annual need. And as we look at the USDOT study they did in 2009, they talked about a $77.7 billion need in state of good repair backlog. We need to invest not in just state of good repair, but also in core capacity. As we talked about these people coming more and more riding public transportation, we're seeing full buses, we're seeing full train cars, we're seeing rail lines that are full. They can't put any more trains on them. The platforms are full. We need to add to core capacity so we have the ability to put more and more people on the systems. It's really, really important that we do that. As we talked about the extensions here, we've had 9 extensions. Next week marks 1,000 days since our surface transportation bill expired, 1,000 days. The average extension's been only 3.7 months. And as Will talked about, let's put it into a set of terms that are easier for people to understand. If you think about our infrastructure, our public transportation and our transportation funding as a whole for the last 3 years, it's a bit like getting in a car here in San Francisco and driving to New York, but doing so with only 3 gallons of gas at a time. So you drive, use up 3 gallons, you gotta go find a new gas station. And you wander about the country trying to find 3 gallons at a time as you work your way across this nation. You're not going to do it the most efficient way. You're not going to do it the most effective way. You're not going to think about long term. You're just thinking about, oh my gosh, I'm running on fumes. What's next? And that's what our public transportation and our public overall funding for transportation in this country has been. It's time for a long-term bill. It's time to give certainty, to give jobs and ability to look at long-term projects across this nation. We had 2 major companies went through major challenges recently. Daimler Bus Division, Orion Bus, just left North America because of the uncertainty. That put 600 families out of work because they closed that bus operation. Big supplier DRI just filed Chapter 11 out in North Carolina because we don't have certainty in transportation. It is critical that we provide this certainty. Transportation in this country provides jobs and access to jobs. It's time to get this country back to work. get our people back to work, and that's why this investment is so important. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. And finally, from the panel discussion, Steve Heminger of San Francisco Bay Area Metropolitan Transportation Commission. Can you talk about the state of transportation in this region, as well as what you learned as a member of the National Surface Transportation Policy and Revenue Study Commission? Steve?
Mort, before I do, let me just say I am going to miss John Horsley. Only John could get that excited about a one-year bill. Always looking on the bright side of life. John left out two important facts, though, I think. One of them is that the only way Congress is going to finance that one-year bill at current funding levels is by borrowing more money from our kids and grandkids, which is not a way to do long-term business in infrastructure. The second is that the idea that he and I like quite a bit of converting the excise tax, the per gallon tax on gas, into a sales tax on gas, we actually came up with it in a little trattoria on the shores of Lake Como in Italy. And believe me, everything looks better there. Let's hope the idea has some staying power. I'm not sitting here hoping, though, frankly, for a lot of extra help from either Washington or Sacramento here in California, which is why our operational model, I think for some time, has been doing more with less. Less meaning less help from Sacramento and Washington, and more means raising more of the money locally, but also being smarter about how you spend it. Self-help is what we call the general movement here in California for raising more in our state. We only get about 20% of all of our assistance from Washington. A friend of mine says they tend to give us 80% of the rules and 20% of the money. But be that as it may, to my right, Will Kempton really got us started on the self-help movement with Rod Dyrdek's help in 1984 when Santa Clara County passed the first sales tax for transportation. Now we've got those taxes all over metropolitan California. In fact, what we have now are counties doubling down on those taxes. Los Angeles has a full 1% sales tax devoted to transportation. They just added on top of that. Alameda County, one of our most populous counties here in the Bay Area, is about to try to say the same thing in November. Now, you might say that's not very consistent with a user fee approach to transportation. On the other hand, if you look at what a lot of those sales taxes are buying these days, they're not buying a lot of roads anymore, at least not the roads that our daddies and granddaddies built. They're buying, in some cases, express lanes that Will mentioned. And I think that's another version of self-help that, in my opinion, is a little more consistent with the user fee approach, where you basically auction off space in our HOV systems, our high occupancy vehicle systems, to motorists who are willing to pay a toll. And they can join the folks in the lanes already who don't have to pay a toll, who are carpooling or vanpooling or taking the bus. And we've got a couple of those projects here in the Bay Area already in operation. Actually, Southern California has been well ahead of this, well ahead of us for some time now. We're planning ultimately a 500-mile network of these lanes, again, based on essentially voluntary contributions, which ought to be a tax that most people can like. Sometimes these lanes are derided as Lexus lanes. It's just a way for the rich guys to buy their way out of traffic congestion. I prefer to think of them as type A lanes for people who absolutely positively have to get there. And if you're from the Bay Area, you know we've got a lot of those people here. And my view is if people are willing to give you money, you ought to figure out a way to take it. Will mentioned performance, and that's the other piece of the puzzle to me. That is what doing more with less means. Our long-range plan here in the Bay Area over the next 25 years is going to devote almost 90%, that's 90% of all the funding we see coming for operation and maintenance of the system we've already built, the one that's in operation today. That places just a tremendous premium on spending the limited expansion dollars we have much more wisely. In the plan that we're currently developing, we're subjecting all expansion projects to a benefit cost analysis, which if you're in business, you'd say, well, you mean you didn't used to do that? Well, no, we didn't. And now we are. We're also implementing a new program called the One Bay Area Grant Program that will be incentivizing cities and towns to build more housing near transit, which not only helps with the housing shortage, but it also brings Mike and his members more customers. And so it kills two birds with one stone. Here in the Bay Area and elsewhere in California, we are continuing our investments in intelligent transportation improvements on the state highway system. That ranges from fairly mundane things like ramp metering to our 511 system here in the Bay Area, to the fact that we've got 1 million accounts now of electronic toll payers. And once you've got the gizmo, why not just put some more readers on the roads and put some at the airport? By the way, you can pay your parking at San Francisco Airport with Fast Track. That technology can be a real enabler in knitting the transportation system together and offering customers a lot more bang for their buck. We're also, I think, taking that approach, and this is a very important step forward, I hope, for us. We're taking that approach to our public transit systems as well, where I think they have not had as much emphasis. We just completed a major piece of analytical work here called the Transit Sustainability Project, which found that for the Muni, the bus and rail system that runs here in San Francisco, the average speed of a Muni bus is 8 miles an hour. Now, Ed Riskin is here, the general manager, the guy who runs that system. I think my bus this morning, Ed, was a little slower than that, actually. But the fact is, you know, Muni could lose a foot race with a lot of people. And if we were able, if I'm remembering the statistic right, Ed, just to get a 1 mile per hour improvement in the Muni system-wide average, it would free up tens of millions of dollars in operating costs that you could reinvest in the system and run more service. That's the kind of thing, I believe, getting back to Will's point, that I think we need to show to the public. Because as long as they see inefficiency, as long as they see bridges to nowhere in federal transportation bills, as long as they see that stuff, I think they are entirely within their rights to be skeptical about giving us any more money. So I do think the reform agenda, and I strongly agree with Will, the reform agenda is probably, back to Mort's original question, what we need to put in place, and probably put in place for a bit of time before we can make the sale with the public. I think one thing they like about these local revenue measures, even regional revenue measures, we've done it twice with our toll bridges, is they know one thing for sure: the money's not going to Sacramento or Washington. And that's a bit of a sad commentary on their lack of faith in those institutions, but that fact, I believe, is what allows them to pull the lever in the voting booth and say, I'm willing to go for it, because at least I can go find the guy who messed up if someone messes up. So the old joke that you often hear about when times are tough and money is tight is that we've run out of money and now we'll have to start thinking. And I believe that's where we are. And I think with the proper thinking, we can find more money too. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve. I think we do have some thought leaders on this panel. For the radio audience, let me remind you, you're listening to the Commonwealth Club of California radio program. Today we're discussing possible solutions to the challenge of funding our U.S. transportation infrastructure. The program is co-sponsored by the Commonwealth Club and the Mineta Transportation Institute. Our panelists include Asha Agrawal, director of Mineta Institute's Finance Center; Will Kempton, CEO of the Orange County Transportation Authority and former director of Caltrans; John Horsley, executive director of the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials; Michael Melaniphy, the president of American Public Transportation Association; and Steve Heminger, Executive Director of the San Francisco Bay Area Metropolitan Transportation Commission, and the President of the Board of Directors for the National Association of Metropolitan Planning Organizations. And I'm Mort Downey, former Deputy Secretary of the U.S. Department of Transportation. Well, we have no shortage of questions that have come in from the audience. I'm going to have to group them into categories, but it shows a lot of interest in this room about things we've been talking about and about a few things we hadn't talked about yet. We certainly have talked about ways and means of increasing revenues. There was a specific question to Dr. Agrawal, but I'll broaden it to others. Your survey and our discussion has talked about alternate ways to generate revenues, but did you look at alternate levels of government which should be acting on those, or is that another set of thinking that we should be carrying out? I'll ask you about other comments from others about that.
Our particular survey was focused on federal level options for raising revenues, so this survey did not touch on that. But that said, I think it's a very useful and important question to ask, and we've already heard from a number of our panelists about the increased trust the public can feel at the local level. That said, my own two cents is that we have to combine local funds with state and federal funds if we're going to have a truly strong national system. And so we really need to think at all levels.
And I think we heard that from others. So there's general agreement on the panel that we need to get to the people at the level they live and work and use the system. Will that work?
It works for me, Mort. I just wanted to add one little feature that's not necessarily directly to the point of the question, but with respect to the survey, whether it's at any level of government, we've just done some focus groups relative to a major transportation project that we have underway in Orange County. Focus groups are small groups of people that you get to try to categorize them into patterns of thinking, and then you bring them in and you sit behind a window. You sort of feel like a cop watching the interrogation of the person that's been arrested. But you do get to pick up a lot of things from these just direct conversations that that people are having with the group of people are having with the moderator. And there is opposition to tax increases, as I mentioned earlier, in Orange County, and people do not like taxes. But what was interesting was when the moderator asked the question, if you were supporting a candidate for office, and you thought the candidate was really the best person for that job, would his or her view on transportation funding, in other words, a toll or a tax on transportation funding, change your viewpoint? And the answer was, over three separate focus groups, the answer was uniformly no. They would still vote for the person. They wouldn't be swayed by the fact that the view of that individual on transportation financing was different than theirs. Education, environment, taxes in general, if those elected officials or those candidates differed with them on those points, they would not vote for the individual. So that was kind of an interesting point that came out of our focus groups. The level of concern, or the degree of intensity, I guess is maybe the best way to say it, with respect to that question, was substantially less than on other very key issues. So,
Mark, at least from what we've observed, the secret to success here in California with your self-help counties is guaranteed benefit to the voters. They know they're going to get something because it's going to be within the boundaries of the county they're in, and they're guaranteed a benefit. Washington State, where I'm from, is the state that has recently raised the fuel tax the most, 14.5 cent increase. But they identified 274 projects in every legislative district in the state, and they have built out all those projects so that the voters got the value for the investment that they have made. The challenge at the national level is to assure states that are going to pay into the system that they're going to get payback out of the system on an assured basis. The reforms that will be in the legislation that I predict will pass this year will help, but also the fact that 90% of the dollars that will come out to the states are guaranteed to come to them in a formula, and we think that will help.
And let me throw out another issue here in the few minutes that we have left. A lot of questions here about the role of the private sector in improving and building our transportation systems. Can we involve a greater degree of private sector activity, both building or operating? What are some of the difficulties? Will, you talked about labor unions as one. And will this work if we don't have good revenue streams? In the current pending federal legislation, both the House and the Senate strongly support increasing what's called the TIFIA program, which is a way of getting federal loans or loan guarantees, but there need to be revenues to pay those back to make it a useful proposition. So what's the thought here about the private, public-private partnerships?
Well, one thing I would say, Mort, is that I believe the notion of getting more private sector revenue into infrastructure is a sound one, and I think there's certainly a lot more we can do. I think the idea, frankly, is often positioned as an alternative to public investment, and I think that's where it runs off the tracks. The fact is, we've got an enormous repair and maintenance backlog in the United States, and the guys at JP Morgan don't have a whole lot of interest in that. We build a lot of public transit projects that lose money. They don't have a lot of interest in those. There are capacity increasing projects, especially for freight and goods movement, where there is a revenue stream that can return the investment and a profit to the investor that I think they will be interested in. But when someone tells you that this is the panacea, this is the thing that will allow all the rest of us to keep enjoying our free lunch, which is to say a transportation system we don't want to pay for, I think they're selling you a bill of goods.
And I agree with what Steve has said, and certainly it is not a panacea. It's, as I said earlier, a tool in the box. But I think the challenge in California is particularly difficult with respect to the issue of employee union involvement and private sector involvement. I believe there is a way to fix that, a way to integrate those services. But it is definitely going to be a challenge in this state.
Mort, in our neighborhood, Mort and I both live in Virginia. The Capitol Beltway, a major arterial that goes all the way around the Capitol, is being upgraded in Virginia. Four lanes are being added, two in one direction, two in another. And the project is being financed by a consortium of private sector folks in partnership with Virginia DOT. It's a $1.4 billion project that Virginia couldn't have done on its own, but Floor, the builder and Transurban, the Australian financer, couldn't have done it just through the cash flow of the hot lane tolls they're going to receive. So the public's in it for about $400 million. The private sector is in it for $1 billion. But it will be paid for by people like Mort and me who pay tolls, and it'll work. It'll be opened like 2 years from now.
I'll be riding Metro, but you can pay your tolls. I think we'll only have time for one more quick question before the radio broadcast is complete. Let me just ask the fundamental, what are we missing? What is the sales point that we're not getting across to the voters, to the elected officials? What are the things they are looking for? Why aren't we making the case? And give me a 10-second answer.
Can I just say, I don't think we're giving them the vision of where we're going and the great future that we can have. We talk about the problems, not the benefits.
I don't think we're successfully making the connection between the economy and quality of life.
Legislators with courage in Washington and Oregon, both of which have substantial increases in fuel taxes, the legislators took the tough vote despite the polling, and it's produced results.
Like, we need projects you can rally behind. I will support this, we will build this, and I'll be able to use this.
I think Ash is right. The fact that I forget which president said it's the vision thing, the fact that they're calling it a thing and not taking it seriously, I think is a symptom of why we are where we are.
I haven't heard much about freight and goods movement. Is that part of transportation solution? How do we focus on that to build the constituency?
I think it's quintessentially what the federal government ought to be doing. And the funny thing about it is...
That little thing called the Commerce Clause.
The Commerce Clause, it gives them the responsibility, yet we really don't have a freight focus or program at the national level. And I think that's because we've been a little bit too focused on subdividing the money by state, or in the old days, earmarking the money by congressional district in the House. If the federal government did nothing else, it ought to do that. It ought to deal with goods movement and freight movement. It's in a position to deal with these huge national railroads. It's in a position to deal among the states. And frankly, the federal government sets the trade policies that are what caused the flow of goods to work in certain ways in the first place. So I have to tell you, and I know, Mort, you have those responsibilities in addition to the long list of other things you do. That's really one of the frustrating things to me about, even at the federal level, the lack of a focus on this issue.
Well, the most strategic state in trade in the whole country is California. A huge volume, 40% or more of containerized trade from the Pacific Rim flows through the ports of LA, Long Beach, and Oakland is a major player. Up and down the coast, California is a crucial player and has to move goods internal to your metropolitan areas, but also bridging across to the entire country. Barbara Boxer recognizes this and has included a $2 billion annual freight program in the bill that may be coming out here in the next few weeks. But that's just a beginning, Mort. You represent,
and we even hope that survives.
Yeah, yeah. You represent a national organization, Corridors and Gateways, and I think we're just beginning to identify the need. It'll take more time to figure out sustaining funding for greater investment in ports.
And I think that if there's any argument to be made for a federal role in transportation at this particular juncture, it is the freight program, and we're giving it woefully little attention. We find ourselves competing against Tampa and Savannah and Seattle when we should be competing against Shanghai and Hong Kong and those other ports around the globe. There needs to be a federal role, and it's only the federal government that can do it. It was like the interstate system. That's the best example of a need for federal involvement in transportation that we have today, and we need to apply that same approach to the freight program as well.
And I would just offer one additional thought. I agree with what else has been said, but if the way to gain support for new revenues is to build a vision that is exciting to people, I think that a certain segment of the public would respond well to an emphasis on freight and goods movement and the economic development links to it. And we've maybe been ignoring that.
Another part of the vision that has excited many people, some for and some against, is intercity passenger rail. Again, another way to link our country and our regions together. Any thoughts about where that fits into the picture and any predictions of what's going to be happening here in California?
Will? Thanks. Well, first of all, intercity passenger rail is something that is also, I think, an appropriate area for the federal government to have some level of involvement in. That we have three services here in California that are actually operating within California, and the state has pumped more than $2 billion worth of investment into upgrading that service. We have the second, fourth, and fifth busiest passenger rail corridors in the country in California. And for 1 month, actually the Losan corridor, Los Angeles to San Diego, carried more passengers than did the Northeast corridor. So that's how close we are. That's how important it is here in California. We're looking to upgrade that in Southern California. We're trying to get a local joint powers authority that will actually manage the Losan corridor, very similar to what you folks do up here in the Bay Area with the Capital Corridor. Working in conjunction with Caltrans and with Amtrak, you have a system that has expanded in a very short period of time from something like 16 trains a day to 32 trains a day, and actually improved customer service dramatically. And so we're looking at doing the same thing there. Then again, I'll bring up the word that probably a lot of people are interested in, that's high-speed rail. In California, we are, of course, hopefully embarking on a path that will bring a high-speed rail system to this state. I think it needs to be done very incrementally, but there's some important decisions that are going to be made here in the next couple of weeks in Sacramento that will have a bearing on the future of that. I hope the legislature and the governor continue to see the wisdom and the vision that is entailed in a high-speed rail system in California and will make the appropriate decisions.
Mort, the French have a train that can connect Paris to Brussels in an hour and a half. Last week I was with the Northeast states, and they have a long-term vision of service between New York and Boston, an hour and a half, New York to D.C., an hour and a half. If they can pull that off in the next 50 years, that will transform and integrate the biggest metropolitan population in the U.S. California, I predict, will beat them to the punch. The complexity of what they need to do in the Northeast is almost overwhelming. You have some virgin territory between your metro centers that may enable you to move faster. The real challenge here is how do you get into the metro area with the complexity of right-of-way and tunneling?
Well, I think this speaks to overall to the fact that it's a transportation system. If we put people on rail, gets them off the roadways, makes more room for trucks, or however you look at the overall balance of the transportation system. As we look at accessibility across our country, whether it's the reduction in rural air service and the ability for small communities to have access to health care and other needs across this country, high-speed rail can be part of that solution. And we can use local transit, local systems to do that last mile to move people across the country. Last year, Amtrak had a record ridership. People are using that service, such as it is right now. If we invest in it, we provide long-term, well-funded, safe, high-speed operation across this country, it can be transformative in how we move people and goods across this nation.
You know, John, it's not so virgin as you might think. There are farmers who own that land, and I'm afraid they're headed to court. I think the high-speed rail project actually is a good case study for a lot of the issues that Will's been working on, which is we're trying to essentially deliver Interstate 5 in the era of CEQA, and we are finding out how difficult that is. The High-Speed Rail Authority, I think, is on their second or third or fourth EIR, and they haven't even turned a spade of dirt. And we've got to get a better way of dealing with rail and passenger rail investment, especially. I mean, if they don't deserve some sort of an advantage in the environmental statutes over building a highway, I don't know what's going on. I mean, you build passenger rail to improve the environment. Now, obviously, it has localized environmental impacts, and you don't want to be the guy whose house gets taken for a road or a train. But right now, we treat it all equally. It doesn't matter what you're building or how much benefit it has to society or the environment at large, we're just going to torture you in the courts for 10 years. And if you want to figure out a way to make high-speed rail unaffordable in California, just torture it in the courts for 10 years.
True of any transportation investment, in fact.
Well, but only we have CEQA, Mort, you know.
True. And we've forced you to have the federal process on top of that, unfortunately. This has been an unusual political process as we perhaps are leading up to a piece of legislation. There has been no discussion of earmarks. Is that a plus for the long term in terms of people saying we need to depoliticize the process, we need to reform the process, we need to get better investments? Is that helping or hurting?
Well, ultimately, the Congress wore out our welcome. Mort, you remember back in the Ice-T era, of when the Act passed in 91, there were perhaps 100 earmarks in that bill. Then when we passed T-21, it increased around 2,000. Then when we passed Safety Lou, it proliferated to over 6,000. It was absurd and totally out of control. People reacted to that. They said, "What in the world are you thinking?" And now we have a more discipline in the system, whether that continues forever. But it couldn't continue the way
exponentially
it was going.
It's a
step in the right direction to discontinue earmarking. I think the political system needs, what is missing is an ability for a member of the House and the Senate to get credit for the bill they're taking a tough vote on. And we still got to find that equation. But what doesn't work is enacting federal legislation that takes everyone's money and then trying to craft it to benefit member by member in their reelection campaign. That can't continue.
Well, unfortunately, we've reached the point where we can't throw out any more questions, but I thank you for the answers so far. I want to thank our panelists, Asha Agrawal from the Mineta Transportation Institute, Will Kempton, CEO of Orange County Transportation Authority, John Horsley from the American Association of State Highway and Transportation Officials, Michael Melaniphy, President of American Public Transportation Association, and Steve Heminger, Executive Director of this area, the Bay Area's Metropolitan Transportation Commission. Today's program has been co-sponsored by the Mineta Transportation Institute, held in association with the State Highway and Transportation Officials, American Public Transit, and the Bay Area Transportation Commission. We want to thank the audience, both here and on radio, television, and the internet. I'm Mort Downey, former Deputy Secretary of U.S. Transportation Department, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club of California, the place where you're in the know, is adjourned.